Listening Library presents Alex Wise vs. The End of the World by Terry J. Benton-Walker. Read for you by Torian Brackett. For Aiden, duty. You were always and always will be more than enough. Love, Daddy. A note from the author. My parents divorced when I was 13, and I witnessed my mom's constant fight to care for our family all on her own. In my father's absence, I had to grow up quickly to help our family survive, much like Alex Wise. During that difficult time, I was also trying desperately to understand who I was and how I fit into the world, a world that often made me feel powerless and like I didn't belong. And when I needed to escape, books were there for me, even though I had to do so by way of characters who were nothing like me. Alex Wise vs. The End of the World is an epic story filled with plenty of wonder, excitement, and humor. Alongside Alex and his friends, listeners will battle homicidal sea monsters, fight back hordes of skeletal zombies with cool magical weapons, and step through portals to other worlds. But at its core, this is Alex's quest to learn to love himself and to fight for the people he loves, no matter what. Black queer kids across the globe are struggling to understand themselves and their place in a world that often makes them feel they don't deserve love. I created the world of Alex Wise for them, to show them that not only do they matter, but they can be superheroes too. Happy listening, Terry J. Benton Walker. Apocalypse Countdown. 4 years, 37 days, 10 hours, and 1 minute. Part 1. A Santa Monica mom snagged a movie deal when her indie podcast about her middle school twin's experience with a paranormal entity they named Mr. Shadow was optioned for film by DoD Productions. Joel Marshall for Movie Reporter Weekly. May 31st, 2020, 2:33 p.m. 1. The beginning of the end. I can't believe I survived sixth grade. This entire year almost blew the gauge on the suckage meter, but I made it out in one piece, barely. And now I'm going to use summer break to set my world back in order. Or I'm at least going to try my best. Kids poured down the sidewalks outside Palm Vista Middle, flooding the air with shouts and laughter, energy renewed by the official start of summer vacation. My best friend and I stroll alongside each other at a slower pace than usual, drinking in the drastic shift in atmosphere. No mountains of homework, no waking up early to get to school on time. Summer break has finally arrived in Palm Vista, California. I don't remember ever liking this place. The last truly exciting thing to happen here was when the Highway Strip Mall got a GameStop and a Cold Stone in the same month. Last summer, I emailed Guinness World Records to nominate Palm Vista as most boring town in U.S. history. They never wrote me back. There's not much to do here unless you'd enjoy an arcade with prehistoric machines that eat quarters like popcorn, or a movie theater with musty, creaky seats and stale candy. My hometown sits smack dab between San Diego and Los Angeles, two places I'd rather be any day, but my preference would not be San Diego. I have zero desire to be near Dad or his new family. I slide my backpack around and peek inside the front pocket. The small white envelope is still safe and sound. I know, carrying these tickets around is pointless. The concert's a week away and I still haven't mustered the courage to ask Sky to go with me. But keeping the tickets close helps me hold on to the hope that he and I might become friends again. I think I'll commit to full-on rebellion and lock my hair, Lauren Blakewell announces as she loops both thumbs through the straps of her camo backpack, the front of which she's suffocated with colorful enamel pins. She's wearing cuffed olive green overalls, and her hair is pulled back into a giant poof, held in place by a black and green ribbon that, of course, matches her sneakers. It's my hair. I should be able to do what I want with it. You're absolutely right. I zip close the pocket of my backpack and swing it around to my back. But if you upset your mom, she'll lock you in solitary for the rest of summer. Loren groans and kicks a rock, sending it skittering down the cracked sidewalk. She must be angry to risk scuffing her Jordans. I think she'd look great with locks, but her mom told her that hairstyle wasn't appropriate for a young lady, and Loren got her phone taken away for a week for calling her mom a troglodyte. That week also rated pretty high on the suckage meter because I'd grown accustomed to having Lauren's usual upbeat mood to distract me from what had happened between me and Sky. So? Loren drags out the word, making my gut flinch preemptively. Speaking of summer break, there's something I have to tell you. What's up? I try to sound unconcerned despite my stomach revving up to full-on Cirque du Soleil. I'm going to LA for break. She winces as if she's the one hurt by the reveal. I still smile. I finally convinced Mom to let me go to Muay Thai camp. Loren became obsessed with Muay Thai 3 years ago when she started taking lessons at the YMCA. At first, her mom refused to let her take the class, but Loren went on a hunger strike and Mrs. Blakewell caved by day two. Muay Thai camp means a lot to Loren, so I'm dev happy she's getting to go. But my heart also sinks into a pit of sludge because I realize my best friend's going to be gone our entire summer break. And that means the only other friend I'll have to hang out with is Sky. Except he and I aren't exactly friends right now. I swallow the lump of anxiety in my throat as I elbow my bestie playfully. That's great, Lo. You aren't mad? She asks. Mad? Nah. Decimated only a little. I'm going to miss you terribly, I say with an exaggerated sigh. But I suppose I'll find a way to survive. Now my mission to fix things with Sky has just become dire. Otherwise, I'm doomed to spend the entire summer with only the company of my irritating human barnacle of a little sister, who had better be waiting at her school's pickup zone like she's supposed to be. The last time she wandered off, yeah, she's a repeat offender, mesmerized by her tablet, it took 20 whole minutes of frantic searching before Loren and I found her curled up on a bench near the playground, reading. The last thing I need right now is Mom grounding me on the first day of summer break because Mags got lost on my watch. Loren and I pass a strip of shops where some of our classmates hang out. Then we turn the corner toward the elementary school, leaving the ruckus of the main road behind for the deserted side street. This part of the neighborhood is silent except for the soft shuffle of our sneakers on the pavement. The back of my neck prickles, like someone's watching me. I look over my shoulder, but we're alone. Weird. I shrug the feeling off, but something snaps across the street, like a twig breaking underfoot. Either Loren doesn't hear or she ignores it as she ambles beside me, deep in thought, likely planning how to kick off hairpocalypse with her mom this summer. Across the street is a row of paneled cottages with plain, reasonable front lawns drenched in the shadows of the mature trees lording over the sidewalk. The windows of every house are dark, as if the entire neighborhood's already left for vacation. Creepy. I start to turn away, but something catches my eye. It looks like someone's shadow disappearing behind the trunk of one of the wide, slanted trees whose roots have broken up the surrounding sidewalk. I stop and crane my neck to see if anyone's hiding behind the tree. No one's there. But I could have sworn. Did you forget how to walk, Goober? Loren, a few strides ahead of me, doubles back, looking confused. I thought I saw something, I mutter. What? She asks, concerned now. Before I can answer, the sound of Sky's laugh snatches my attention. He's a block behind us, walking alongside his new bestie. Sky's shoulder-length sandy brown hair is up in a ponytail, and the sun has flushed the freckly strip of skin beneath his forest green eyes and across the bridge of his nose. He's wearing a faded San Diego Padres tee, the baseball team his dad, the famous Judas Hollowell, pitched for before he retired last year. Nothing, I tell Loren. Let's go. She shrugs, and we continue toward the elementary school. I glance back at Sky, who's so engrossed in his friend that he hasn't noticed me walking ahead of him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.